Okay. Okay, hello everybody. Good afternoon. Thanks for joining. So people in live and people remotely, thank you for joining. I guess you can hear me. The mic is on, right here. Is it on? Okay, thank you. People online, can you hear me? Okay, perfect. Thank you very much. Okay, as said, thanks for joining. So last week we looked a bit at classes. Oh no, one thing I want to say first is, and I was actually just reminded by somebody. So that's especially important for the people online. Whenever you ask a question, could you please hear people here? So if you people, the people in the room ask questions, please remind me to repeat it so that the online people can hear it. Because I know how I did it the last weeks. I remembered the first time and I forgot the second time. And then I assumed that this was the correct behavior. Of course, this is very wrong, and I'm, well, please try to remind me. Whenever you ask a question, please can you repeat that online? And for the online people, if you have questions, well, I will try to repeat them, or maybe Mikael can try to repeat them, so that also that people in the audience can get that. Okay. Are there any questions so far? Administrative questions? It's clear for everybody. So who uses Git here, maybe in the room? Okay, who doesn't? Who doesn't want to use it? Okay, so most of the people use it. Let's try if that also works with the online people. Can you use this raise hand thing? How does it work? This, oh no, this yes thing. Who uses Okay, yeah, quite a few. Okay, thank you. Okay, great. So that's good. That's good. So that you get used to that. So version control is very important. You will use it if you do any serious programming at some point. You will have to use it anyway, and so you get used to it, and it's always good. Well, we just look at Git, put them in the order system. So depending on what company you start or what research group or something, what else, they might be using a different one, but they all use the same concept. Okay. So if there are no questions, administrative questions, like about the course, the organization and things like this, I just repeat it because maybe it's not very clear. I know it's kind of long to have 90 minutes in a row. Believe me, it's also long for me. But it's really because of this Corona regulations. After roughly 90 minutes, I will try to make it always a bit shorter. We have to leave for like 25 minutes the room so that the air conditioning cleans it from whatever could happen. Okay, so I know it's a bit long. But yeah, that's unfortunately how it is. That's the wrong computer. Okay, so last week we spoke about classes. So if I can go to full screen mode. Yeah, we spoke about classes. We looked at some basic principles about classes, some very easy stuff. Which probably more if you have programmed that at some point in your life. Some language like C++ or Java or I don't know, Python, whatever you have programmed at some point in your in your life, then this thing should rather be familiar to you. And by now you have started using it when you program the Penner model. I hope it's a lot of fun. So yeah, classes are basically things to kind of an extended data structure so that you can create your world. And yeah, we do it here in an object-oriented way here. So the basic principles are just listed here. But it's a rather big subject. There are lots of books written about it. So we just look at the basics. And well, the principles are really that you can abstract stuff. So you create a certain abstraction. Instead of directly working with pointers and memory, you work with maybe your own matrix class or vector class or whatever. Or you use somebody else's vector class or matrix class. Other thing which classes allow you in C++ is to encapsulate things, so to hide implementation details from your users. Okay, and this is not really to be, you know, mean, that to not show people how you do it. It's more about that it gives you the freedom to change things later on. So it gives you the freedom to change things. So try to hide as much as possible. Only kind of the interface, what users from the outside are able to use, that must be stable, because if you change there something, you break the code of users. But this, of course, also applies if you write your some code for you. So you will see for the Penner model, if you start messing around with the public interface, so the public members, the public functions or whatever, if you start messing with them, then, well, your code will break. Okay. Inheritance, you will see that later on. And polymorphism, yeah, classes also allow you polymorphism. We have already seen one form of polymorphism, and we will talk about it today again, in the form of templates. So we do some generic programming. As said earlier, templates by itself, they don't really exist. They are just kind of like a blueprint. It's like a nice plan of some house, but unless the house gets built, nothing is there. And the compiler builds it for you. It's called instantiation if you use the template. This means that, well, you have to, well, to use it to cause instantiation. It means that the whole thing needs to be available to him. That's why generally you put that into the headers. Okay, that's it. Yeah, that's this. Since it happens at compile time, well, we will refer to it as compile time polymorphism. Okay, now that's the wrong computer. Okay, so classes are basically collections of members. There are like three types of members: functions, data, and types. You can put other types into your members as members in your classes, and we will do that today. In a rather funny way, when you look at type threads. And the set access is kind of, you have these three access specifiers: things that are public, available to everybody else on the outside; things that are private, things that only you within the class are able to use, so person who writes the class; and protected, so that also people who derive from it can use it. We will use that maybe later in the Penner model at some point. Yeah, that's it. Again, wrong computer. And yeah, last week we talked about a few things there. One thing which I want to remind you is constants. Constants are really important. So constant member functions, or constant parameters to functions, constants are really important. It guarantees that things won't change. Always try to make stuff, if you know that thing shouldn't change, make it constant so that it remains that way forever. Otherwise, the compiler will yell at you. Okay. And today we look a little bit about this special member functions, which we looked at a little bit slightly last week, slightly more in detail. Like this few special member functions. So the constructor, which constructs an instance of some class, so an object, it builds an object. If something comes to life, well, you want to kill it at some point, or it has to die. For that, you have the destructor. And well, in C++, you have control over everything. So you dictate, so you say, or can say to the program what it means to copy stuff, what it means to move stuff. we will look at some of these here later on. But just to say here, they're kind of called special member functions. In principle, they are nothing else than functions, but they have a special meaning. Some of them, or at least these here, they might be synthesized for you by the compiler if you don't specify them. Again, wrong computer. Okay, constructors. So we looked at it, the default constructor last week. So what's the default constructor? Well, that's the thing which gets called when you basically ask for an object of some class. And it's the thing, it's called default because you can call it with no arguments. So if you say class A and you want to create an object A, well, that's the thing which gets called. People are sometimes confused. They would say, okay, for instance, for the complex class, which I said it last week, but I stress it here again, for this complex thing here, well, that doesn't look like a default constructor because it has arguments. Yes, it has arguments, but you can call it without any specifying any arguments because it has default values for these arguments. So it's still a default constructor. And you can overload constructors. We will do that today. So you can have several constructors. And yeah, it's one of the special functions. So if you don't specify a constructor, well, the compiler will generate one for you. But you have to be a bit careful. Well, okay, for the constructor, it's probably you know what you're doing. But the generated one, the synthesized one by the compiler might not do what you want. Okay. Another thing which we look at is if you can declare it explicit, it kind of prevents certain funny conversions, implicit conversions. That's sometimes a bit surprising. Make an example later. Well, the destructor basically destroys objects. And when you destroy something, well, you want to make the necessary cleanup. This is not always needed, but sometimes it's needed. We will make an example later on. So for instance, you could be handling some resource, which would be some dynamic memory. So some stuff which you allocate with new, well, then you want to delete it too. It could be that it's some file, that if your constructor opens a certain file, well, you want to close it. It could be some network connection to some database. If the object goes out of scope, well, you want to close the connection. The destructor. And well, one nice thing in C++ here is that it's automatically called as soon as an object goes out of scope, so you don't have to do that manually. As long as you do everything cleanly, then as soon as the object goes out of scope, well, the destructor is going to be called and it will make the necessary cleanup. It looks fairly simple, but sometimes it can get rather complicated. Yeah, you have a question. Out of scope, that it's what the question was, what do you mean by out of scope? It means that it's not reachable anymore. So for instance, you arrive at main bracelet at the end. All objects which you have created in the end in main, well, they will die then. In the scope in a function, it's basically between the braces there. Does this answer your question? Okay, thank you. And thank you for reminding me that the first time I already forgot. Okay. So yes. Another thing which is rather nice, they are called in reverse of construction. You can imagine it a little bit like a stack. So let's say I create a chair. In the next line, I create a MacBook. Okay, maybe in the next one, I create this mic here. Okay, now if I start destroying in a different order, for instance, I pull down the chair, my laptop is going to break. I know this doesn't really go on. It's like making for the online people, sorry. But anyway, so it destroys stuff in reverse order. So it takes this mic thing, whatever. It destroys then the laptop. Okay. And then in the end, the chair. So think of it like a stack. You put stuff on top of it. Well, the first one to die, to get destructed, was the last one created. Exactly for these reasons here. Again, wrong one. Okay. So this guaranteed destruction kind of makes it very convenient to use it for resource handling. This is called usually in C++ world resource acquisition is initialization, the RAI idiom. It's somewhat a misnomer. Basically, it just means that if you make a resource, it's done with the constructor, and the destructor cleans it away. It has nothing really to do with initialization. It's more actually about the cleanup and the destruction. But we'll make an example later on. Now, in C++, you have a lot of control. So you can actually control how objects get copied. That's sometimes what you want to do. So for instance, for the Panda model, what does it mean to copy an animal? Is it a clone? Is it a living thing? Or maybe you want that it does something else. When you copy something, then it's a child. Okay. Who knows? But anyway, you have total control over that. And the signature basically looks like this. Okay, so it takes in a constant reference to the thing that you want to copy, and it creates a new instance, which is a copy of that thing, of the C here. And for instance, it gets invoked here. So let's say C is already an instance of the class. So it's an object, C. Here I create C1, so I copy constructed by copying it whatever is in C. So this is a copy. Which seems a bit strange sometimes to people when they see it the first time, is this thing here. So here I kind of declare C1 should be of type C, and I equal it to C. So this looks like assignment, but it's really just a copy construction. It's just a synonym of that one. Think of it like when you assign a number. And then, of course, with the uniform initialization, though you can also put this curly braces around it. But they all mean the same thing. It's also one of the things which gets implicitly generated for you. If you don't have any custom, copy construct, of course, but any move constructors. We will discuss that later on a bit more in detail. But the important part is, if you don't specify it, what it will do, it will copy all your data members member-wise. We make an example later on that this, sometimes one needs to think a little bit about that. Copy assignments. So what does it do? It copies an existing object into another already existing object. Copy assignment. So I show you here. It has this signature, and you always think the signature basically says what it does. I mean, it takes a constant reference to some C, and it gives you back. A reference also to some other C, basically that already exists. You copy whatever is in this guy C here into this object, so the this pointer, basically the, and return the this pointer. And just that you see maybe the different. I mean, it's rather subtle, and sometimes when you look a long time at code, you tend to forget that or don't see it. I mean, these are sometimes very 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 funny bugs. Here I use the constructor. So basically here the default constructor is called because I don't use any arguments. Here I copy construct C2 from C1. Here I copy construct C3 from C2. But now I copy a sign, C3 to C1. Here I make a chain of assignments. So I copy assign C1 to C2, which then gets assigned to C3. And this is why you want to return the this pointer. And always keep that in mind, even if that thing here looks stupid now at the moment, C3 equal to C3, well, people tend to do that. They don't do that willingly. They usually don't know that they are doing it. You have a question?
What is the meaning of copy assignment?
What is the meaning of copy assignment?
What is the difference with the other
copy that we're doing? Okay, so I just repeat your question online, just not if it's the right thing. So what is the difference between copy assignment and copy constructor?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Copy assignment copies something into an existing object already. Copy construction creates a new object and makes it a copy of something that exists. So it creates a new object. Does it explain your answer? Exactly. So something is already there. So that's why I say, it doesn't really look much different, right? This line and this line, if you just look at the equal. But it's rather subtle here. Here, basically, I say I copy construct C3 by this thing C3 didn't exist before. Now I say, make me an instance of that object, make me an instance of class C3, but copy the, make a new one, but copy whatever is in C2 in it. Here, C1 already exists, and I copy in it the content of C3. Okay, yes, there is a question online. Oh yes, okay. Let me see if I can fix that. Okay, no, unfortunately, I had some issues for actually joining the meeting, my own meeting. I had some issues to join it. Is it? It's better now if I move it a little bit closer. So I just continue like that and will try to speak a bit louder if that's better. Is that okay?
Some people are
happy, some people are not happy. Is it better when I'm closer to my laptop? No, it's a funny thing, but it could be that it's my computer mic, which the mic of the laptop. I know it sounds stupid. Okay, really sorry about that. I actually don't really know what's happening. I had some troubles to join the meeting here anyway. And there was a question. Okay, let me try to repeat the question. So you say, how does one distinguish between this equal and that equal?
No?
No, you don't have to. It depends. So you don't really have to define it. But if you don't, and some circumstances are fulfilled, we look at the table later on, because it's I also look at the table, but essentially if you don't define it, it could be that one of them is based on some conditions, is generated for you by the compiler, and it will do just a member-wise copy construct or a member-wise copy assignment, which basically means that if your members, your data members, all have this stuff already implemented for you, then your member-wise is perfectly fine. I hope I also repeated more or less correctly for the people online. Okay. Now since C++ 11, there are also things to move stuff. So instead of copying, making duplicates, you're also allowed to kind of steal the guts of an object, allowed to empty it. So it looks funny. We will make an example later on, but yeah, we'll make an example later on. What this basically does, it creates an object and moves the content of whatever C is into that new object. So it basically steals the content of whatever was in C. It's like when you move to a new apartment. You don't move the apartment to the new location where you live, you just take out the furniture. Neighborhood might be nicer. Okay. Same thing for move assignment, so that you steal the stuff which is inside a certain object that exists, and you move it into an object that already also exists. So it's moving. These two ampersands here, they look funny. So reference, reference. It's usually pronounced ref, ref. It's a so-called R-value reference. It's a reference for something that is not assignable. You can think of that. It refers to a temporary object. And why would that be useful? We will make a very detailed example about this at some point later. But look at this thing here. So here I create an instance of class A. The class A, you see it here. It has all the funny members here, the special members defined. So it has a constructor, it has a destructor, it has a copy constructor, it has a copy assignment, and it also has an operator plus. Okay. And okay, all these things are defined. Okay, they don't do anything; they just reply to you whatever is happening. And if you look at the operator plus here, now you need to look very closely. What's actually happening is, okay, whenever I do here the A plus A, okay, then this operator gets called. I hope that this is no surprise for anybody here. But what's happening here is the arguments. A1, what I do is I pass it by value. What does that mean, pass by value? Yes, it's a copy. The other one, I pass it by reference. Constant reference, because I don't want to change it. Always make things that const if you can. And I return here this A1. So, okay, I don't do anything here, but I basically return it. Why should that be something new? Why should a new thing be created there, A plus A? Well, because usually you want this value somewhere else. And what's, okay, let's see, what's essentially happening is something like this. If I run this command here, so, okay, the compiler sees A plus A, calls this guy here. This guy, well, here a temporary gets created, so this A1. It's a temporary, we are not going to use it later on, which is only for the return statement of this function here. So you create this temporary, I should have called it A1 to be like in the signature over there. And then it makes the plus here, it adds stuff. We'll make an example which is less dummy than this later on, where we actually add stuff. But this is really that you see what's happening. The next step here, this I put it in green, that's the next plus here. Well, again, the same thing happens. This guy gets called. It passes by value the first argument. Well, that's the first argument here. Well, it becomes a new. It becomes this next temporary here, and then this one is passed by a constant reference. Okay, and then it returns. Well, again, the copy of it. Okay, and in the end, well, what happens here? The assignment. This temporary gets copy assigned to A. So I hope this doesn't really look too much surprising. It looks a bit strange. And you would say, why would I care? Sometimes you care, especially if, for instance, A are huge matrices. They have lots of data in it, for instance. So all these copies could be expensive. And all these things, well, they are just temporaries. I'm never going to use them directly. So that's why move constructors and move assignments could be nice. So, okay, for the first thing, I have no choice here. But later on, that's just a temporary, okay, this thing here, so I don't really need to copy construct it, I don't need to copy it, I just can take out the expensive stuff of it and just put it down there. I just move the stuff, the guts in it, and do the same thing here, and the last temporary here, I move the assign that thing to A. So usually copying is more expensive than moving. We will make an example later on. Instead of copying the whole content of your matrix or of your huge array, you simply reset the pointer to some different location. Okay. This example here, just that I say it, so this example, you find it in the demos, just for running. This little example sometimes looked rather funny and rather stupid, but it can help in some circumstances when you don't really understand what's happening. Why isn't the move constructor or the move assignment called? Why? What's happening? So you can test it with such little things. Can be quite nice. And here we barely just scratch the surface, so that's why I'm not going to discuss lots about it. But there are things like called value categories. There are L values and R values. R values usually refer to temporaries. L values refer to things that have a memory access, have a memory address. Yes, you have a question. In this example, where does the destructor get called? Yes, for all these temporaries here, at the end of the assignment. I didn't put it on the slides because otherwise. Yes, there's a question. But thank you for the question. In the example, did I repeat it online? Okay, thank you. So it's on the demo, you see that it's called, otherwise it's a huge mess, you will see. Yes, you have a question. Here? Yeah. Okay, because I defined it here. So if you look, that's class, I should repeat it for the people online. Why is the move constructor called in this example here? That example is actually really bad. Thank you for pointing that out. Thank you. So here it's class A. Class A just has copy operations, copy assignment and copy and a copy constructor. Now class B has also the move constructors and move assignments. But since I'm a bit of a lazy bastard, I just copied the other slides and forgot to put that this should be B's. Everywhere should be B's here. But I should have put that's an object of class, an instance of class B. So of that. And then all these things get called temporary, so that thing is an R. R value reference, so then it gets swallowed by this guy. Did I put it? Yes, this guy, so the move constructor. Yeah? Okay. But you see that it's a temporary. Why it's not really used at some point anyway later on. You see that. Same thing happens for the compiler. You see, okay, this thing, well, its lifetime basically is for this just there for this statement. So it's really just, if you write like the return value of a function, if you don't save it somewhere, the value, let's assume that the compiler doesn't optimize it away, the value gets created, but then throws away, and the compiler knows that. Yes, you never call it explicitly yourself. You let the compiler do it for you by writing such statements there. And thank you for pointing out that the example, well, okay, I'm lazy here, thank you. Are more questions? Okay, if not, as I said, this thing can be a bit confusing time to time. All sorts of values, C++ 11. Before, like in C, it used to have things like L values and R values. And the name stands basically for something L values that stands on the left side of an assignment, R values on something which can stand on the, which can only stand on the right side of an assignment. And then some other expiring values, pure R values were introduced. But this is we don't really discuss that here in much detail, but if you want to have a look, can have a look, but it can get ugly at times. But what I wanted to make clear with this example is, I hope that everybody sees that sometimes moving can be cheaper than copying. And to remind you that all these things actually happen when you write a simple statement like that. Later on, we will even try to avoid this, even that it's move constructed. We will try to avoid all these temporaries here by using what is called meta-template programming. But that's for later on. Maybe let's summarize this here. So special member functions, the constructors and the destructor. So default constructor, well, and here you see when it's when it gets implicitly defined for you. So for instance, if you look at the copy constructor, well, it gets implicitly defined, so the computer generates one for you if there is no move constructor and no move assignment. So if you don't define one of them, this guy gets defined for you. The important thing, the default definition, just does it member-wise. Okay. One thing also in C++11 that you can use is the keywords default and delete. When you want to specify that some of these guys shouldn't get generated or should get generated default-wise, you can say it in your code. That's actually quite nice, so that even that it looks like a bit over too much information, but it basically says that, okay, I want the default constructor. That's a statement in the code. I'm happy with the default one. And that you know that. For instance, also if you want to delete certain operations, certain things shouldn't be copied. You might want that certain things are not allowed to copy. You don't want that. So then you can delete them. In older code, what you sometimes will see is that to kind of mimic the deletion, what people did is, well, they declared this special member they want to delete. So let's say you don't want a copy. You don't want to allow a copy, one of these copy guys here. Well, you just declare it in the private section, which is not usable for the world outside. So you see that sometimes in code. Okay. So that's usually the guideline which people show. This is just that you have seen it once. We will not really discuss it much in this course. It's just an introduction here. But the most important rule is basically the last one, the rule of zero, the rule of no work. No work is always good. So if your classes, for instance, don't require any destructors, copy, move, and copy, move, assignment things, then it's always better. Let other people do it for you. So if you, for instance, in your genome class, you have some bit set or whatever you use there for the genome. Well, the bit set, for instance, already has all these things implemented for you so that you don't have to care about it. So member-wise, moving stuff around is fine. Exactly. So try to use stuff that has that in it. Are there any questions here? Maybe I should stop from time to time. Okay. If not, let's make a few examples, kind of to be slightly more concrete here. We consider again this very simple point class. So remember, it's a rather easy thing. It it has a type member here, coordinate t, that's how I store my coordinates of a point. We do it only two-dimensionally, and we have this member functions here. Okay, in this example, what's missing? What's bad here? Something I said initially at the beginning of the lecture. Does this function return coordinate, so give back the x coordinate? Does that change the coordinate? Does that change the point? No, it doesn't. I see some people nodding their head. No, it doesn't. So what should I have done here? Yes, I should have said it's const. So I should have said that that's a constant member function. So this is a bad coding. And not only it doesn't change it, it shouldn't change it. So it would actually be really wrong if asking for a coordinate of a point, for asking for the x coordinate of some point, if that one would make the point move. That would be catching something in the wind. Now, but the question is more about this here. What are these things here? So what is this? What gets called here? Does something get called? Exactly, for this guy, the default constructor gets called. Well, it's this guy, because you can call it without specifying any arguments, because it has default values for the x and y coordinate. A default point should always be at the origin. You can put it at your home, but you would have lots of points at your home address. What gets called here? The second line. Exactly, again, the constructor, but this time with the arguments that the x-coordinate is going to be set to 1 and the y-coordinate to 2. What gets called here? Yes, the copy constructor gets called here. Here again, the default constructor gets called. But what happens here? What gets called here? Exactly. So even that, well, I just have defined here the default constructor here, a constructor. Well, all the other guys, copy, assignment, all these things are generated for you by the compiler. And for this thing, that's exactly what you want. It will copy member-wise the coordinates x and y. It just copies doubles. So that's perfectly fine. Okay. Yeah, that's overloading a different operator. We have seen that last week, I think. It's just simple operator overloading. So you can overload all your operators which you want. And here it's just an example about the extraction. What is the insertion operator? So the pretty printing of a point. Maybe try to code the extraction operator so that you can read from for instance, from the standard input, you can read coordinates of a point. Maybe some more interesting things, operators. So the compound assignment statements, so add equal, so plus, minus, times, divide, whatever. In the table which you have seen last week, so this is, you can define them as member functions only, and you should always return a reference. Because some people tend to like to write things like this. So do basically as the ints would do, for instance, if that would be all be integers, and here would be a plus, that would be allowed. And if you implement now the plus assignment, so plus equal, so simple operator overloading as usual, well, we pass in the thing which we want to add to it. We only pass a reference to that thing. Because we don't need to pass it by value. We don't want to have a copy here. But we also pass it in by constant, because adding this right-hand side to whatever this thing is shouldn't change the right-hand side. So if you write A plus equal B, that operation shouldn't change B, and I hope you agree. And that's exactly what's implemented here. Other things than the binary arithmetic operators or symmetric kind of operators, they are best implemented as free functions, as non-member functions. So for instance here, I define outside of the class as a free function, the operator plus. It takes in two constant reference to two points, P1 plus P2. And it returns a result, well, simply the x coordinates and the y coordinates added. That's how you do it. Okay. Now, there is a little detail. Sometimes one can take some shortcuts, some more elegant implementation here. So here I explicitly really wrote the thing what the operator plus should do, point one to plus point two. I really explicitly wrote it here, but I can use some of the special member functions and the ready plus equal assignment, the compound assignment statement operator I've defined before. So what I could do is, okay, let me make a copy of whatever P1 is, so I pass by value. So this is a new thing, which gets initialized as the same thing as P1 in the statement that we write, A plus B, so this is going to be A. And then I use the plus equal, the compound assignment I've written up here. So you can implement it in terms of the compound assignments. Why is this slightly better than the other thing before?
It's not wet.
Exactly. Oh, shit. It's not that wet, so I don't have to repeat myself that much. And the nice thing exactly, so that this simply reuses something up here instead of writing a totally new addition here. For a simple thing as this here, this looks like who cares, but for more complex things, this can be very helpful. Okay. Something that is always sometimes surprising is the argument-dependent lookup. So who decides on what gets called when you call a function in your code? It's the compiler. How does he decide what to call? There are some very specific rules. So the function needs to be available somewhere. And for instance, here I create a namespace called geometry. So I put my point into my geometric geometry namespace. There might be other useful geometric stuff like lines, spheres, planes, whatever. And down here, I kind of create a point. So here, I need to use the scope operator, right? I want the point which is in the namespace geometry. So I need to use the scope operator. P1, I created with x coordinate 1 and y coordinate 2. And here, for instance, what do I use? I use the overloaded the pretty print function, which overloads this operator here. Here, for instance, I have some function in this namespace here, which is called func. Here, I explicitly call func, but I could also call it like this. This is sometimes a bit surprising, but because this see here, when I want to create the point, I need to use the scope operator. Why don't I have to use it when I use the overloaded operator here, which is also in the scope of which is defined in the namespace geometry. Same thing here. I explicitly call the function which is in this namespace, but I don't have to. The thing is, to make life a little bit easier, in C++, what's defined is this so-called argument-dependent lookup. It will look into the associated classes and namespaces of the objects you're operating on. So this is it's also known as König lookup. You can find it, and if you really want to know the whole details, because this can be quite complicated. I mean, it's nothing really difficult, but there are lots of cases. But it's just to say that, okay, here the function p on P1 might be defined here in the namespace geometry, and it will find it because it will say, okay, I don't see in the current scope here, I don't see anything that is called func. Let me also look in wherever P1 is. Well, what is P1? It's a point which is in the namespace geometry, so it will try to find this function somewhere in there. Okay, just that you have seen that once. So depending on the argument, something gets called. Okay, it broke down again. Ah, cool, thanks. That's even better. Are there any questions so far? Yes. Sorry? Yes. Yeah. Yes, for inheritance, so the question is for concerning inheritance to find the right function. We are going to discuss that in maybe two or three lectures. But essentially that's what's happening. It goes up the inheritance hierarchy. But we will discuss it, yes? Yes. Cascading, yeah. Okay, yeah.
There's a question online as to if both functions exist, so a free function func and a geometry func.
Yeah.
Which one will be called with ADL?
Okay, that's an excellent question. If both, if the signature would be okay, so if both would be swallowing points, well, then that would be an ambiguous call, I would guess. The compiler would yell at you, I guess. Yeah. So that's one of the questions. That's an excellent question. Well, we can try it.
I think it's well defined, but I don't know the answer off the top of my head as to which one gets called. I do believe one of them actually gets called. Pretty fine, but we'll check.
Well, which one gets priority? That's the question. Okay. So now let's, if there are no more other questions, let's look at a slightly more interesting example where we actually manage some resource and not just move around points. So let's build our own simple array class. It's basically a stripped down vector. Two simple vector, and let's so it's something like this. So we do what we have seen. So we use we define some type members. So for instance, for the size of the array, we define a size type. Unsigned int kind of makes sense. Don't use int directly. I mean, an array of size -5 doesn't really make sense. And whatever the elements are, let's say we want to make our elements in the array should be doubles. So we define that there. And let's write the private data members. So we don't give that access to the public. We have our size, the size of the array, which is of type size type. And well, the elements here, well, they are a pointer to somewhere where you allocate memory. So, yes, these things are public, the private size and the pointer to the elements of the array, and we have the default constructor, which, well, uses the initializer list. And if you default construct an array, what should it be? It should have size 0, and the element pointer, the pointer to the elements, the dynamic memory of the array, that should be just a null pointer. It's nowhere. Okay. Now let's make it slightly more useful. Let's add another constructor here. Sometimes you want to construct arrays of a certain size, so of a size 100 or 1,000 or whatever. So let's add another constructor that takes in as an argument a size, And then we simply said, well, the size to whatever, how big, how large we want our, this array here. And we create some memory here on the heap. And we set the LM pointer, the pointer to the elements, to that thing which we generate here. Okay, in principle that already works, right? What should I do next? Any suggestions? Okay. Next thing which you probably want to do is, well, if you allocate something, you probably want to deallocate it. So we simply add a destructor. So we add a destructor for cleanup so that the whatever memory which we asked for, we give it back. And that's fairly easy to do. So we add the destructor, something like this here. Okay. So here we manage a resource, which is simply some chunk of memory. And if we construct it, well, we release it. Okay. Now, we cannot do much with this thing at the moment, but what we can do is we can create arrays and we can destroy them. If we try these statements here, what does this do? This default, well, this creates an empty array where, well, the size is zero and the element pointer points to the null point, is the null pointer. Here I create the array B of size 10. What does this statement here do? Anybody has an idea? C equal 10. It's a bit surprising, but what this thing will actually do is will create you an array of size 10. Sometimes a bit surprising. And that's probably not what you wanted to do when you wrote this code. This is just to remind you that this thing is just a synonym of that thing. And to avoid that, well, we can make it here explicit so that no... you should make this constructor here explicit so that, well, essentially this here, well, doesn't create you an array of size 10, but you really need to call it, there is no conversion of this int here to this unsigned int here. Okay. Now since we need to copy things, let's see. We have defined the constructor and the destructor. So in principle, copy constructor and copy assignments here, do they work? Does the compiler generate it for me? Any ideas? Yes? Yes, the element-wise copies, that's what you say, the element-wise copy is not going to work. Exactly. That's the thing. But first, just to answer the question, yes, it will generate for me a copy constructor and a copy assignment, but it's going to do the wrong thing. It will just do member-wise copy, but you're absolutely right. So here I create an array, well, an empty array of size A. Here I copy this empty array into B. Here I create an empty array of called C, and here I assign that guy to that guy. So here it would actually still fly, but the problem is if you want to do if these arrays wouldn't be empty, if they would really had some memory in it, well, you would just pass on the pointer, so you would have multiple arrays pointing to the same location in memory, and that's usually not what you want. So we simply define the copy constructor and the copy assignment constructors. And well, we do them relatively easily. So the copy constructor takes in a constant reference to whatever array you want to copy. Copy and generate a new one out of it. When it copies, it should have the same size, of course. But it should also allocate some new memory. You want it to be a distinct, to have its own memory. And then you simply copy over the elements. Right? Oh, that's a nice copy constructor which creates a new array of the same size with the same data as whatever you want to copy, but at a different location in memory. It's a real copy. But the copy assignment, well, this, here it's slightly more tricky. So what we do is, okay, we want to there is already an array A, and we want to copy into that array A another array, let's say B, which might have a different size and some different, of course, different data. So what we do is, well, we pass it again by constant reference. So if you look at this code, is this going to work? Is this copy assignment going to work? Okay, let's see. There is something dangerous here. And I've shown it to you on one of the slides earlier. What happens if you self-assign? Is this going to work? Who thinks it's going to work? Who thinks it doesn't work? Okay, who doesn't know? Okay, so who wants to know? Just that I know. Okay, so if you self, okay, thank you. So it's sometimes a bit difficult when I ask questions. I'm never sure if people don't care or if people don't are totally lost with what I'm saying, that I'm progressing too fast. So sorry for that. So please tell me if I'm going too fast. But the issue here is self-assignment. So if I say array A equals to array A, this thing gets called. I get the constant reference to this array A. I delete the thing which I want to assign to, which in that case is the same thing. I delete elements. And I create elements of the same size, and then I want to copy stuff over. But I've deleted that guy. That's annoying. So always think about the self-assignment. Usually you don't do that on purpose, you do it because you don't know that something is the same thing as something else. Yeah, it's not something that you write for fun in the code. That was your question, right? Yeah, it's not something, okay, let's write A equal to A. No, that's not something you do for fun. Sometimes you don't know. It could be the return of some function. And it's the same thing that you try to assign. You don't know. Okay, so what should we do now? So there's this technique which is called the copy and swap idiom. So we introduce a new member function here that swaps. A new member function here, it swaps simply the content of whatever it's called on. So S array, some array A, I call swap, let's say with B, then that's the other guy. Simply their stuff gets swapped. So I swap their size and I swap their elements. Just the pointers, just an exchange of pointers. Now does something surprise you here? Who can explain what I'm doing here? What does that come on to using standard swap? Yes? Uh-huh, okay. Okay, so maybe first, what does just the statement do? What just this using statement do? What does it do? Just the using statement. It brings into scope, into the local scope, swap whatever is in the swap in the standard, right? Okay. Now, if I call a swap like this, then it could, for instance, be that this swap is going to be called. But it could also be, the swap version in the standard, it's some templated thing. And the compiler, or the standard, tells you if there is something better. That's next argument. Sorry, I will come to that later on. But yeah, that just brings into the local scope swap, so that I can call it. And then if I have this swap function here, so this swap member function, I can actually do this here. I can implement the copy assignment with the swap, with this swap member function. Now, why I have this using here is that I could implement maybe an optimized swap for my data type, a simple array. In that case, it doesn't make any sense, but it could be that I implement one, because I know it better than, for instance, the one that is implemented in the standard. So I could implement maybe a better one. And the compiler is actually going to choose, it's always going to prefer a normal function that you have implemented to a templated function. Okay, is this going to work for self-assignment? Who thinks yes? Who thinks no? Who doesn't see it, why it would work for self-assignment? You don't see it, why it works for self-assignment. Okay, let's try. What happens if I... where is it? No, here. So what happens if I call the copy assignment operator with the same object? Okay, A equals A. Okay, A equals A, so A is just also a constant reference to A itself. I create a temporary copy here, so using the copy constructor, copy right-hand side into temp, and I simply swap the content of temp with the right with this object. So I make sure that there is something. I'm simply reassigning it, but it's not going to destroy anything and trying to access it later on. Yes, you have a question. There is an online question.
So there is a question. There was a question online to like three slides ago about the destructor.
Yeah.
Why do you assign in the destructor after you delete LM? Why do you then assign LM to null pointer?
To the null pointer.
Yes.
Why I do that? When something doesn't point to something valid in memory, make it point to the null pointer. When I delete this thing here, well, I just say delete the memory there. I'm not saying, well, put the it's just going to leave the pointer dangling somewhere in memory. Here I explicitly say put it to the null pointer. That's the reason. It's just hygienic, making things clean. Usually, for instance, in C, you will sometimes, or also in C++, sometimes when you pass in pointers, when you pass pointers to functions, you always have to make sure that the thing is not pointing to the null pointer, then you know, okay, this thing, I shouldn't touch it. So it's always a good idea to make the thing point to where it should point, the null point, so the nothing. Another question?
Well, I wanted to expand on that. It also, because you might have somehow saved a reference to this LM, and then you will still, so delete doesn't actually change the value of LM, it just deletes the associated memory. So if the new,
exactly. The
new will, the new will say, if you say new int 10, you'll get 10 ints somewhere in memory, and then delete will just make sure, will just bookkeeping wise get rid of this bookkeeping and say, okay, this area of memory is now free, but the pointer will still point to the same place. By making it point to the null pointer, whenever you would dereference it or you would try to delete it again, you will get the program will abort due to an error because you're not allowed to do that. So it prevents bugs that might happen.
Okay.
And the second point I wanted to make was about the using std swap.
Mm-hmm.
A few slides further.
Where is it? No. Wait. Yes, here.
So there is actually another reason why you do std swap. It's because you can. There are certain parts of the standard library that you're allowed to specialize to make work for your own types, and std swap is one of them. So you remember for the epsilon function, we looked at you can implement it with templates, you can implement it with overloading. You can also implement std swap yourself for your own types. And then by introducing using std swap, you pull it into scope so that it will be available for argument-dependent lookup. And then the compiler will automatically use the swap that best fits and that is best optimized for whatever type. So if you provide it with your own version, then it will use that.
Yes, but didn't I say something along these lines?
I mentioned the fact that it can be specialized.
Okay, I didn't mention that it can be specialized, but here what I would do is making local.
Yeah, but it's the reason why we have
to use. It's a specialization, yeah.
Why we have to.
Yes, you're absolutely right.
So if you define a swap, why would you call it a standard swap?
Because that if I haven't defined one, you mean? If I have defined, why would I want to call the standard swap?
Yeah.
Well, it could be. So, for instance, later on we will make that that the elements are some template. So that the elements are not just some double, or that could be something else. It could be some other object. It could be, if you do, I don't know, finite elements, it could enter finite element meshes. They might have a swap in there, but if they don't, you default to the other one. So sometimes you want always to find something. If then it doesn't do the correct thing, that's also that's a different question. But you will always find one in that case.
Thank you.
There was another question. No? Okay. Now let me see how many slides I have left here. Okay. We are soon done with this. So the compound arithmetic statements just follow the same guidelines as before. The compound arithmetic statements, well, make them member. I have a choice, and they are fairly easy to apply. What does this here do? Assert. What does this here do? We had that maybe in the first and the second lecture. Yes. Exactly. So it verifies this condition here. If the sizes are equal, you cannot add to arrays that are not of not equal size. But here, actually, the really correct answer would have been, it depends. It depends if you have defined n debug or not. So okay. And then you can simply, the symmetric, the binary arithmetic operators A plus B, you can implement them out of the class, so as non-member, as free functions, simply using the compound arithmetic operators. You can implement all the others. There is an example in the demos where everything is worked out. It suddenly gets pretty complicated, but I hope that you see on the slides more or less what's happening and have a detailed look at the code and try to run it and maybe try to understand what's happening. Because it soon gets rather messy, you know, there is a plus, there is a minus, there is a divide, there is whatever. So it bloats up a little bit. Now, one thing which you also often need, well, because as before, I mean, we were able to add an array, but we were not really able to assign something to that array or to access the elements. So you want to implement the subscript operator, right? The angle brackets. You can implement them in these two ways, like this here. But the catch here is you always need a copyable, so a non-const one and a const one. Why could that be? Why would I need two of them for a const and for non-const? Somebody has yeah? Yes, absolutely, but when would I ever need that? Hopefully it's on the, no, it's not on the next slide, but so sometimes when you, it's a rather stupid thing. So this guy would actually work in most of the cases. But at some point you might write, you want to pass this simple array to a function, which says, okay, I'm not going to change that array, so I make it const. And suddenly this guy cannot access it anymore. You cannot access it with the elements because it's a non-const member function. So that's why you also need that guy. Is that clear? Okay. Yes, and what? No, I went back, sorry. Okay. And of course, the next thing you want to do is, okay, now I have my simple array for doubles. Now I want it also for integers, and I want it for floats, and I want it for whatever. What does one do? Well, one does a template. So in C++, you also have class templates, and they are declared exactly defined the same way or similar way with the keywords template. And you say whatever, well, this type which you don't specify, T, type name T. And then you simply replace here, for instance, the elements or simply stuff of value type T. Maybe you also define a reference. What's a reference? Things like this. It makes the code a little bit readable. And here I follow explicitly the standard, for instance, the standard vector, how it's implemented there. Whenever you implement something, try to look how the standard does it and try to mimic it. There's a simple reason for that. They are doing it since quite a long time, and they probably know what's best. Okay, and it's also very general. Are there any questions? Yes, you have a question, sorry. Standard library, standard template library. Still. It can also mean something else. Yes, the standard template library. Yes, sorry. Yes, sorry. Other questions? Not, I mean, just that you see a notation here. So here it's just how one, for instance, defines an out. What is it? Yeah, that's sometimes surprising to people outside of a class. So outside of the class, you want to define a member function. Well, you need also to make it a template. And this notation, well, it sometimes a bit confuses people a little bit. That exactly. And this notation also, why do I have to put, for instance, type name before that thing? I have to make sure that, I mean, this thing, SRA, is a template. So unless I specify what T is, the compiler doesn't know what it is. But I don't specify T because I explicitly say it's a template. So I have to assure to the compiler, please believe me, whatever that thing is, I'm accessing here a type member. It's a type name, believe me. So this notation looks a bit strange, but it's really just to tell the compiler what's. I promise you it's a type. Are there any other questions? So if not, let's try to go to the next thing. Again, templates. Maybe type threads. And some the generic programming, we are going to do it maybe next week. We have seen that already with the minimum example. It's a rather boring example. So nice way of programming a generic minimum function for any type T for which, well, this operation, this order relation is defined. We have seen that. But this works very well if the argument input have the same type T. So if you pass in two ints, two doubles, two floats. But in principle, you might want to allow things like that. So what would be the correct answer? What would be the correct type of minimum one double and two integer? Well, we are going to make a decision about that later on. But what happens, what we did in week three is, okay, we could also make the return type a template. But then we need to call it like this, and we explicitly have to specify, okay, I want that the return type is an int, or I want that the return type is a double. Those are our manual solution. Same thing now, maybe slightly more concrete. If you have one of the simple arrays of type doubles and one of type integers, it makes sense to add them together, as long as they're of the same size. But well, the question is then again, okay, you have this add operator, symmetric add operator, which takes in, it's templated over the type on the left, let's say A, and the other thing B. So it's also could be different types. So for instance, float and double, or integer and double, whatever. And here again, we could simply make another template parameter. But it's a kind of an annoying solution, because every time you need to specify the return type, what you want. And what we in principle want to do is, what should be the return type if you add an int and a float? You want to decide on that. And essentially what we want try to do is kind of like manipulate types, work with types or compute with types. For instance, one idea would be, okay, if you add an integer array and a float array, just take the type that is bigger. Well, float. Bigger in size, bigger in representation, the span. And we will see an example right now, and so this is usually called a threads. Okay, let's quickly do the minimum example here together. What we essentially want to do is make a function that works on types. I have my minimum template, which has these two template parameters, t and u. And based on what t and u is, I want to return something. And I call it the minimum type. I make a class template here, which has a member called type. I just define it in a second. That's the thing which kind of returns me, based on what t and u is, what should be the type of the result. Okay, since this thing, at the moment it's just a template, right? The whole thing is just a template, it's just a blueprint, it doesn't really exist. So I need to assure the compiler that this thing is actually a type. I need to tell him that. Can do exactly the same thing, for instance, if you want to add two simple arrays with two different types. I say, okay, what should be the return type if the left operand is t and the right operand is u? It should be some type. And I decide what it is. So if I add a float and a double, I could say, okay, the return type should be a double. Okay, but now the question is, okay, I've written it down nicely here, but how do we do this? Is this clear for everybody why type name is needed here? Who doesn't understand that at the moment? Because that turns out to be important. I hope I've convinced you about, you know, the blueprint. Yeah, you? Okay. So a template is just a blueprint. It doesn't really exist, right? If I write this here, it should work for any t and any u. Compiler has no idea what it is, right? It doesn't know when he looks through it. So at some point when he wants to check, okay, but okay, is this valid C++? Is this I need to give a return type, right? You have return type, function name, arguments, and their types. I need to kind of tell the compiler, look man, believe me, this thing is going to be a type. I need to assure him that whatever that thing here is, depending on what T on whatever T and U is, this thing is going to give you a type. I need to assure him that. in the end, when he puts everything together, he will check anyway. He will see if all the stuff makes sense. But it's as a first reassurement. Look, please believe me so far. You will see later on. And that's usually also one of the problems, that when he tries to use things, then it's already quite late in the compilation process. So you will not get a simple error message telling you, hey man, that's not a type. You might get something else. Yes, you want to add something?
Yes, so this is, so to say, to make the compiler easier, because it eases with parsing, because you tell the compiler that the next token will be a type. I think since C++ 20, this is no longer actually needed, because compilers have moved forward and people have seen that it's easier to just have the programmer not worry about this, and they can make the compiler logic a bit more difficult, a bit more complex, and it will still work out.
Okay, cool. Did you present that in last year's C++ 20 introduction, or was it still in the
I'm not sure. It's not like a super big change.
Okay.
But it's called kind down of with type name.
Okay, good.
Paper.
Thank you. So I wasn't aware of that. Thank you very much. But you will see that in practice a lot of times. So how could we do this? And the means how we do this is it looks that easy that one doesn't really see what's happening. Sometimes things look so easy that it's not clear. But that's why we'll try in the next kind of like 5 minutes to make that hopefully very clear, because there will be an exercise about it. So let's make the definition of our minimum type that selects based on T and U a certain type. And we will use class templates for this. So let's define a general template which depends on two template parameters, T and U. Let's make a struct so everything is public, but I make it empty. This will become important later on. Now I partially specialize it. Okay, I take away one template parameter, say, okay, if U is the same thing as T, that's exactly what I'm saying here, well, just give me back the type in this min type struct should just be, I make a type def which is called type, and that should just be T. When I access it here, for instance, I exactly access this type member. That's why I define it here. And if T, so T is equal to U, U is equal to T, well, that's, I specialize that guy here for that. And now I can fully start specializing. So I don't have any template parameters anymore, but I want to specialize the template. So I don't have any template parameters anymore, but I specialize here the general template. And now I can decide if T is float and U is double, I want that the type is double. That's my decision. If T is double and U is float, I still want to return kind of the bigger type, make it a double. If something is a float and something is int, well, just give me the bigger type, give me back float. If something is a reverse way, if it's int and float, give me back float. So can somebody tell me what's the return type of minimum 1 and 2? Yes? Yes, it should be int, exactly. Can I ask you the follow-up question, which template it's going to use? Exactly, the partially specialized one. Now, for minimum type 1 and the float here, what's going to be the return type? Yes? Exactly, it's going to be float. Can I ask you which template it's going to use? Exactly, this guy here. It's going to use this guy here. Is this clear for everybody here? Okay. In the exercises, it will get you will have to deal with these things. But always it's as simple as that. Why did I put some dots here? Somebody has an idea why I did put some dots? Exactly, there are many more types. In principle, now I could specialize for everything. I could customize it to whatever I want. Okay, that's just saying this. Merde, what happened here? It works exactly the same way for the simple array template class. Class template. It works exactly the same way. We simply define a sum type. That's it. Exactly the same way. Shouldn't confuse you if you see that in code. Such things are called type threads, and they are used all over the place, especially in the STL, in the standard template library. But they are very convenient. And the funny thing about them is that they're actually happening, they're kind of like stuff that happens during compile time. Yeah, it's just about types. Yeah, okay, it happens at compile time. Doesn't really look fancy. In one or two slides, we are going to make an example where we are going to use templates to program something. And in a few weeks, we will look at even more fancier stuff. But anyway, these things are so-called type threads. So these are the if you stumble up them, these are kind of old type threads. You pass in a type, and it will give you some answer. But the old ones gave you lots of answers, kind of like a multivalued function. And that's not usually when you have a function, you get back one value. I give in this type function, this type thread, I give it two types, float and int. I don't want the whole collection of things back. I just want one answer. Yes, here, that's the convention. And since C++ free, so there's a different convention. Everything just returns you if it's a type that it should return, well, you store it in the member named type. That's convention. You could call it whatever you want, but then other people might not be able to use your code because they use the convention. You can also store some values. I mean, a template can also be some value. For instance, here I could. This is the struct is integral type. I make it a static const, a bool. It's in general false. If something is not an is integral, means is it an integer type? But I know that int. Well, that's one of the most famous integer types. So I will set. I specialize it for this type int. Well, then the value is true here. Okay, who is confused by the static here? Okay, nobody, it seems. A little bit, slightly. Okay, but too shy. Okay, so remember, am I going to use objects of this type somewhere in the code? Who says yes? Who is unsure? Okay, so no, I'm not going to use it in the code. I'm never going to instantiate this struct somewhere. I never create a real instance of it. And if you never create an instance of it and you still want to save something, you should make it kind of like a struct variable or a class variable. And then you make it static. That's what we have seen last week. So that it even exists if nobody ever instantiates that thing. Right? Hope this somebody still confused about the static? Seems not to be the case, that's good. Okay, give me just three more. Let's briefly go through this guy here. Maybe slightly more meaningful example, an average example. So you have a simple, imagine the simple average function here, which takes in a vector. Well, you don't specify the type here, so it's a template. It can be of any type. You pass it in as a constant reference, and you simply compute the average. Right? What's the average of something? Well, usually it's of the same type than the elements of your vector. So this is t here, and you give back a t down there. And you simply accumulate that thing, you compute the average. Does anybody see any problems here? So for instance, for vector double, what's the result if I give to this average function this vector here? What's the average, yes? 2.5, yes. What's the average of this guy here? Yes? Exactly, 2. And well, you could argue that could be annoying, right? You might still want to get the 2.5. So for instance, if all your grades were integers and it's rounding down, you wouldn't be happy about it. So if all your, if we graded all your submissions to the exercises and we might round you down, you wouldn't be happy about it, computing the average. Some of you might be lucky and we would round you up, maybe. But it's not really happening here. Anyway, so what we want to do is, well, we want to make an average type based on what t is, the type of the elements of the vectors. Yes, and we do it simply here. So this is a type name, average type, and it, we store it in this average type class template under the member type. Okay. Don't get, you will see that in the demo. So all these things are implemented in demo so that you can try it and run them and try to understand them. Here, don't get confused by this thing here. It's simply a nice way of printing the name of the function. I think it's special to GNU and Clang, but it will give you the signature of the function. It will give you the exact type of it so that you can reason about it. So it will tell you what t is. So we still need to define our average type. And let's do it in this way, as simple as before. We first define the general case, okay? Here we make the general case to be, okay, whatever t is, I'll make it just t. And then we go through the special cases. So for ints, hopefully you're seeing that's a bad answer here. I still want that my average type is of type doubles. So I explicitly here, I specialize my average type, and I can do it well for all the other integer types. This is exactly what we ask from you in the exercises. Do you have any questions concerning this? Is this clear to everybody? To whom it's not entirely clear? Okay, no, it doesn't seem to be the case. But now you would need to repeat that for all the integer types, and there are actually quite a few. But for the exercises, this is enough. Next week, we will look at an automatic way of doing it, and that's the first contact with programming with templates, meta-template programming. Okay, now I suggest that we, if there are no questions, sorry for overstepping again 9 minutes, I suggest that we make a 25 minutes break. So we are back at what would be 10 before 4. So we all have to leave the room. So the people online, we now leave the room and we are back at like 10 minutes before 4 with the exercise class.
Yeah, that works, huh? Cool. Okay. I think there we are. Okay. People online, can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. Ouch, that desktop. Yeah, yeah, thanks. All right, so I assume everyone can hear me, right? So then let's check out the solutions for the last exercise, yeah? Okay, so you had first exercise, the SAT2 group. Okay, so let's look at this. Big enough in the back? Yes, big enough, very good. Okay, so what you had to do was implement the group operation on SAT2, right? And that was this part. So, you know, if you have plus and plus or minus and minus, you would get a plus, and else you would get a minus, right? And that's very easily written with that ternary operator question mark. Yeah. So if this is true, then it returns to first. And if it's false, then it evaluates to the second. Yeah. That's it. Then you want it to be able to print it. And that can be written in the same manner again. And remember to always return this OStream object. OK? Then you should operate the group action on numbers. And as I told you last week, you have to implement both ways, right? So once you have some number here and SAT2 on this side, so that would be A times B, and you can also have B times A, right? And that has to be implemented as well. But now the implementation here is very simple, right? If we have a plus, just return the number, and else we return minus the number. And now for the other case, to make it consistent, you should really just return A times B, right? So you essentially call this operator up here, but with the arguments inversed, right? Because now, if you think, maybe I have to change something, then you only have to change it in this function here, right? And the other one, you know, just carries it over. Okay, so that's a thing you may want to do, because else it can get confusing, you know. Then you change something up here, but not down here, and things like that. And then you also need to copy code if you implement it again. So yeah, that's the way to go. Okay, and then you should implement this power function. This is actually a fairly efficient way to do it, because it halves the power at each step. You can look at it and think about it once I upload the solutions. But yeah, that's essentially how it goes, right? And you can see how the identity element is used and stuff like that. By the way, just so you see that too, this is the implementation of the identity element and then the specialization for SAT2. Okay, so yeah, that's essentially it. Do you have any questions about that? Let's check Zoom. Oi. Yeah, no, they're just discussing my setup. Okay, so then let's go to the next exercise.
There is a question about the power.
There's another question. What, in Zoom or what?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Can explain how you implement power, your idea behind it. My idea. Okay. Okay, let's bring this up again, right, and see what's going on here. So, okay. So, you start. So what you want to return in the end, what is going to contain the power, is this res, right? That has the type that you pass in, and also which is the same type that you return, right? You initialize that to the identity element, the multiplicative identity element. Okay, that's one for normal numeric types. And now, if the power is not even, then you multiply res by a, and that the remaining power would then be even, right? Because it's reduced by one. You know, so you would now, after this step, you would have to calculate res to the power of n minus one, right? That's what's left. And then in each step, you essentially square the number that you multiply. So you square the input each time you go through this loop here, and that halves the remaining power that you have to do, right? And you would then multiply res by a, okay? Because at some point, you know, imagine that n is 2, for example, right? Then you would go through here, come here, n is n divided by 2, so n is now 1. You multiply the input by itself, so you square it, right? And then you run through it again. Now n is 1, right? So we execute this step, exit the loop then, right? And then we're done, right? So that's the idea. So you kind of square it at each step, as opposed to just multiplying it by itself once again, right? That's kind of the point. Was that understandable? Yes, thanks. Okay, very good. So then, now we can move to the next exercise, yes? Which was Simpson. So here, you should make your Simpson function work with function objects. Now, a way to do this is to put a template both on the function, right? That's this part here. So the function type is templated, and the exercise also asks you to put templates on the interval boundaries, right, where over which you integrate. Now, whenever you introduce a template, so in this case T and F, you need to specify what properties those types have to fulfill, right? Because this function here needs to be callable, right? It needs to overload this function call operator, because down here, or even here, we use that operator on the argument, right? So if that's not implemented, this is going to fail. So that means you need to tell the user, okay, look, you can essentially input any type here as f, but it needs to have a function operator. Yeah, it needs to supply to support that syntax. And then it can also specify, you know, what should it return and things like that. Okay, the same applies to this type T, which specifies the interval boundaries, right? It needs to be assignable, because down here we use an assignment and things like that. Okay, you always need to specify this information as soon as you use templates. Okay, we have another question here. Here we lump. Okay, here we assume that f returns type t. They can be different, can't?
No, it says in the comment, we assume that, or f has a requirement that the return value of f is convertible to t.
Are you unmuted on Zoom? No, okay, then I will just repeat. So in the highlighted line here, it says that f has a return value that can at least be converted to t, you know? So that kind of fixes that, okay? Is that the valid explanation? Yeah, it was. Okay. Okay, so that's the story here, right, for the header file. And also, half the people whose hand-ins I corrected did not have include guards. You need include guards. This is not style, okay? There's many things that are taught, many things that are important, you know, people feel strongly about, but they're not binding, they're not important because it's style, okay? And this is not part of that category, okay? You have to have include guards in your header files because else compilation can fail. You can have all kinds of errors that you will never figure out, you know, and then it's going to be not good, okay? You need include guards. That's what they look like, okay? If the symbol simpson.hpp underscore HPP is not defined, then we define it. So a subsequent check will not have this fulfilled. And in the end, we have an endif, okay? That's it. That's an include guard, okay. Good, and then in the main, well, you know, we make a struct that overloads this function call operator. Here it is, right? Operator brackets, takes one argument and returns this, okay? And then we can just use the Simpson that we just looked at before, okay? And that's actually with a function object. That's the one with the function pointer. Okay, any questions on that? Zoom. Oh, something on Zoom. No. Okay. Good. So that's the Simpson. Oh, yes, there was also the question, what happens if you call it with integer boundaries, right? And well, if you look at the Simpson, if you put t to an integer, then you have an int here, and you return an int, right? So everything would be an int. And because you have very small delta x's, or what is it called here, delta r, right? Those small pieces that you integrate over, those are, you know, will have a result that is often less than one, so it will be rounded down to zero, and your result will usually be zero, okay? That's what happens, right? Everything is an integer here. Okay, good. So yeah, there's a CMake, you can look at it. Then we had the Pena. And we have two things, right? We have a genome class and an animal class. That's what it specified in the exercise sheet. And I mean, you know, this will be highly individual for all of you because you came up with your own implementations and things like that, right? But here are the things that were thought of probably about 100 years ago, you know. So that's one way to do it. There's a couple of things in here that shouldn't be in yours because that it's not actually in the paper, I think. For example, an animal can be pregnant or an animal has a probability to get pregnant, right? That stuff is not in the paper, I believe, but you know, that's just a generalization. So then after the reproductive age is reached, you don't just always spawn a copy, well, a mutated copy, right? But there's a certain probability attached to it that can be done, but you know, that's not in this very paper. Okay, but that's one of the ways to do it. And now let me just briefly, because that's slightly confusing, explain something. So we are dealing with animals, we are dealing with genomes, right? And now the genome, what does that actually mean? So it's gonna be some kind of bit string, right? Assume something like this. Is that still big enough? Ah. Something like this, okay? And now what does that mean, you know, if that's your genome? Because the point is, this is not some kind of representation of a genome, it's something different. So now this means that, I'll deal with Zoom in a second, but this means that at H1, this individual, you know, suffers some mutation that is bad. Right, then at H2, that's the first digit, at H2, same story. So now we have two of those deleterious mutations, right, that are bad for the individual. Then at H3, nothing happens, very good. But at H4, it suffers another one, right? Then at age 5, nothing, age 6, nothing, and at age 7, again. And now we have 4 deleterious mutations, and there's a threshold that for the number of mutations that are bad that the individual can survive, right? And assume the threshold is 4. So now, for each coming year, the individual will have a certain chance of dying, right? Which is given by this Verhulst factor, okay? So that's how this goes. That's the idea of that genome, yeah? So keep that in mind. That's kind of, there's a timeline attached to these bits, okay? That's not just something that you have, and that's the thing we're dealing with, but that's that goes with the age, right? You go through this. Okay, so now let's look. We have some little somethings here. Looks like. Yes, indeed. So if you want to have feedback, you open an issue. Well, there's two ways. Either you send a mail to the mailing list, then we see it, right? We all get that. But if you open an issue, then you need to mention us there, right? You need to mark us in some way such that we are notified, because we're not going to go and check 100 Git repos each week to see if there's a change. We don't do that. So just, be active and explicitly tell us to do it. And even better, if you tell us what you would like us to look at. You know, if you tell us, look, I did this, I spent some time, but it doesn't compile. And I assume, you know, it might be somewhere here, but I can't figure it out. You know, then we know specifically what to look at, and we can kind of target our feedback at your actual issue. On the other hand, if you just, you know, want to show us what you did, such that we have a course look over it, you can just hand it in, and that's it. We'll look at it, right? But if you want targeted feedback on a certain thing, then tell us about it. By all means, we can discuss, we can look at it. We have a question in the lecture hall. Yes. You mean for this specific question?
Like yesterday, I went on my branch, and I noticed that there was another branch called feedback.
Yes.
And then in there was the feedback, but I didn't know it.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah, that's how this generally goes. Yeah, sometimes we would create another branch, feedback, that's a typical story. But then sometimes, you know, I see a setup that already has a trillion branches, and that's just, you know, I'm just gonna, you know, just go in there and put it in. That's it, you know. So yeah, but typically you would get a feedback branch, and the idea is then that you would look at it and merge it back into your master, right? And then that's the way it continues, kind of. People here disagree slightly about the details, but that's the idea. Okay. All right, thanks, I'll do that. Okay, very good. Okay, that's all from me. So now we go over to Georg, right?
Hallo?
Can you see my screen? Geshared ist es eigentlich schon, oder nicht?
In Zoom macht es geshared.
Ist es, sollte eigentlich geshared sein?
Ja.
Ah ja, passt.
Okay.
Perfect. So let's get started. I will present the exercise number 5. The first exercise is quite straightforward, and surprise, it's again the PANA model. So what we ask you now is to basically implement all the nice methods that you already defined in your HPP files. If you haven't read the paper, I think now might be a good point. So I will not talk about this exercise a lot as it's quite straightforward. The second exercise is the multidimensional integration, which is again the Simpson, but this time in two dimensions. So we ask you to write basically a function that integrates over the domain, basically a rectangle. Can I also switch the screen here? Let's try this. Not working. I'll switch it later.
Screen switching.
Sorry, guys, give me a minute. Unfortunately, it doesn't work like it should work.
Now I understand. Yeah, Moment. Ich hab schon verstanden jetzt. Ich bin nur überlegen, wie ich den richtigen Screen dort jetzt drauf krieg. Aha, jetzt habe ich es gecheckt. Yes, okay. Ich war ein bisschen confused. Okay. Aha, so funktioniert das.
Yeah. Okay, sorry guys for the delay. Now I know what I have to do. Aha, das muss ich noch anstecken, oder wie? Hat jemand einen Adapter für das Teil? Ah, nein, nur das Audio hier.
Nein, das ist nur Output.
Das ist nur Output. Das Ding muss ich.
Turn on your laptop, all of you.
Yeah.
It should be
in the. Oh, I was on mute. Sure. Oh, man.
Zoom. Now you can hear me. Yeah.
Perfect. here, but this is on Zoom now?
Yes.
This is on Zoom.
Aha. Now I understand. Okay, guys, sorry, I didn't understand how this works. Now I finally understand. Okay, let's do it like this. Share screen. Also, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we will just go through the code like this. I will have to turn my neck, but that's fine. Okay, so we will start with the most tricky exercise, the third exercise. Hmm? Yes, of course. Yes. So we'll start with the third exercise with the type traits, which I find quite hard. So it's not an easy exercise. So I will give you also a lot of hints how to solve this exercise. So the idea behind it is now we want to go back to the Simpson, but we want to infer the type. So maybe I think it's the easiest way if we go together through the template and then figure out what we have to do for this exercise. So if I go to the main on the bottom here, we see that we have a lot of different function calls, and most of them are with us a functor object that we have already seen. And the thing now is, for this functor object, which is defined on the top here, we have two different types, an input type and an output type, which are basically templates. And now when we want to make a call and want to infer the return type, we can simply go here in one of these function calls. Where is it? This is so hard. Yeah, for example here, and basically infer the types from the template arguments here, for example. And then you basically have these two types that I just showed you on top, the return types, the output and the input type. But now we have a problem. There's also a sine function. And this sine function is just a normal function. It doesn't have any specific input-output return types. So we have to find a way how we can still access this return type, this input and this output type. How can we do this? Well, don't worry, type traits. Here you can see already some to-dos. And in the top, there's also a HPP file which doesn't exist, which we ask you basically to write. So what you have to do is to write basically so you will integrate the function that has also, again, basically a result type, which you can infer from the input and output types. In order to do this, what we want to do is, so we want to basically write two structs which gives you the right type back. And then you want basically to specialize the structs, the traits, for the sine function. So basically what you want to say is, if the input of the template is some sine function, define the corresponding return types that we want to have.
had a really nice example for you guys, but I'm not sure if I can show this to you now. Give me a second, it should but not work. Oh, wonderful. Yeah. That makes it much better. Ha! Finally, getting the hang. Maybe let's first finish the type traits. So maybe a small recap on type traits for all of you that didn't get it quite the first time. The idea behind it is pretty simple. We have basically a template class with a struct and define some type. And then we basically specialize this templated struct depending on the type that we want. So for example, we have a filter type that we are interested in. Let's say, for example, we write a function that doesn't make sense for chars or strings. Then we can specialize this sort type for char. And here it makes not so much sense. Would make more sense if we would have a boolean in here to test. But here, for example, if we want to say this is a certain type, then we can define a desired return type. So that's actually exactly what we want to do in the third example, where we want to specialize, depending on the sine function, we want a desired return type. So this is actually the thing that you have to do in the exercise, a little bit more complicated. And then, you can, the way you use it, you just say sort type, T, and you can access the return type. And this you want then to use in the integrator that you write. Some more hints. This I already told you. For the sine functions, it's difficult because there is nothing. I think I told you all of this. Feel free to ask questions. It's not an easy exercise. I found this was one of the most difficult exercises, but it's a really cool exercise. Then back to the multidimensional integration. So this is basically what you have to do. And what we want to do, we want to reuse the Simpson integration that we already implemented. So we don't want to change it at all. Basically just use your implementation of the Simpson that you already have. And now you can do the integration in two steps, which is possible. The only problem that we have is that the function that we have is a function with two arguments of x and y. And if you recollect from your implementations of your Simpson integrations, the Simpson integration takes just one argument. So how should we solve that? There are different ways. So one of them is, for example, standard bind, which looks like this, where you can basically bind predefined function values to your function already. Another way that is even easier is, which I would really highly recommend, are lambda functions. We have seen them already, and I think you used them also already. What you have to make sure, though, is that you capture the right variables and take the right choices if you use references, capture, or external references. And then you basically can also, if you're aware that your Simpson function should now be a function that is templated, so it can basically return a function and not only a value. And then you can basically, with these lambda functions, create a sort of nested functions. That's basically the goal of this exercise. Do you have any questions? can upload them. Other questions from the chat? Oh yeah. No. Yeah. Then I would suggest start working on the exercise and ask us questions whenever you need. Thanks. Ja, ja, ich lade die an den Hochladen. Mache ich jetzt gleich.
Can I quickly say something? There is a small error in the master solution for exercise 4, and therefore also in the in the skeleton code for exercise 5. I just pushed an update onto the repo, namely, static member functions cannot be const qualified. So you can't have static, I think it's on line 23 in animal.hpp. You have static ht get bad threshold const that doesn't work because a static member function cannot be const qualified because there is no concept of const. If you have a static member variable that is const that doesn't change, that should be const, not the function.